This is Promise Christian University, Level 2, Defeating Dark Angels, the 8th week of 10 weeks. I'm going to open in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you right now for your love for us. Father, I thank you for what you're doing in each and every one of us, that you're taking us deeper. You're healing us, Father, of things that's been here for years. And Father, that you are creating us to be without spot or wrinkle or any such thing. You're raising up that army. You're raising up those laborers, Father. That, Father, that there is a harvest field. Your people are crying out to you. You see their tears and you hear their cries. And Father, it's not just a class to feel good or to learn something, to say we've learned something and put a paper on our wall. But this is to equip us for kingdom work, and to glorify your name, to set the captives free, to bind up their broken hearts, Father. So, Father, we thank you for this great work. We give you honor, glory, praise, and thanksgiving for it. Take us deeper. Holy Spirit, you're our teacher. We ask tonight that you would speak to every heart, every mind in this house tonight, that you would take us deeper in Yeshua's name. Amen and amen. Well, tonight, we're going to just kind of bring it all together. I don't know about you, but the more I hear, the more, I don't learn something the first time. It takes me time. Even, you know, I know you guys know I study the Jewish roots, but do you know I have to read it over and over and over? Is anybody else out there like that? I need to hear it more than just one time. I need demonstration. I need hands-on. I need to hear it, to see it, to touch it. And I know that's how the Holy Spirit teaches us. Isn't that wonderful? So tonight, how do we pray for someone? How do we do the application of what we've been teaching? Again, if you have time, you want to get a history. You want to just listen. People will come and say, pray for me. Well, you want to know what you want to pray for. But many times, what the person needs prayer for today, it didn't start today. There's pus pockets. There's patterns. People go back, even to the mother's womb, as we've been talking. Things that we pick up, it's almost like baggage that we pick up along the way. Have you ever taken suitcases with you on a trip? And somebody might pack like I do, and I could probably take 5 suitcases with me. You know, just my shoes alone to go with the different outfits need a suitcase. And so sometimes we pile things in as we go along, and what we're going through today usually didn't start today. There's problems we're having in relationships, and it surprises me. Maybe it doesn't surprise me, but even in marriage, you'll find that the challenges you're having today is not what you're dealing with usually. This cup, let's say. You know, some marriages, relationships, you can argue 2 hours over this cup. And when you're done, it's like, really? What were we arguing over? But you know what? It had nothing to do with this cup. It might have been that dad threw hot water on you as a little girl with a cup that looked like that. And so you're dealing with that emotional pain of something in the past. Is that true with anybody out here? If you feel rejected, you go into a church. You know, I hear so many people in our church feel, I don't fit in. Nobody likes me. Or I feel rejected when I go there. Precious ones, you're probably not feeling rejected from the people here. You've got a problem with rejection and abandonment. Because when you come in and you feel like you don't belong, then there's something more going on than today. If you feel like the sisters in the Lord are clicking over here, then maybe there's something going on in your childhood where you had cliques going on around you and they kind of secluded you. They pushed you out and you felt uncomfortable. Anybody? I remember going into churches and I would start talking and I wanted to be heard and I wanted to have people like me, and somebody else would come in that was really exciting. And they would be talking to me just like hanging on, listening, and all of a sudden, oh, so-and-so's here. And everybody would go running to so-and-so and talk to so-and-so and leave me kind of standing there. I had rejection and abandonment. And the harder I tried to be accepted, the more I got rejected. And the more I would act out, I would think I had to tell greater stories to make you listen to me. And the more stories I would come up with, the more people would get bored with them. But I didn't know that. So what the problem today usually isn't your problem today. So when you're listening to people, really listen. And then ask them for their history. Let's go back. Well, you know, when did this start, you feeling rejected? How far back did it go? Or ask them, and you might not be able to go in. I have the privilege of having an office and people come in to talk to me, and so I have that privilege. But start just talking to them and normal, like a friend, and just start asking questions. And so you're getting a history, and you might have an opportunity to write it down. Don't worry about your spelling. Don't worry about how you were. I am the sloppiest writer. I'm the sloppiest speller. But I know what I wrote. I made a note for me. It's not going to be graded. So many of us lacked schooling because we were trying to survive. Now, some of you are incredible turning in your homework. It's like you guys went through secretarial school or something. But, you know, my work is not that great. People ask for my notes. It's like, really? So don't worry about, you know, the spiritual realm doesn't care what your spelling looks like. But you know what it is, amen? So if you can't take physical notes, take mental notes. And I'm going to give you just a quick example. I've been talking with my oldest sister. I love my sisters very much. They're not on fire for the Lord. They gamble, they drink, they smoke, they do all these things. But God's working in their lives. God called me just to love them unconditionally, not to preach to them, not to do anything. But my oldest sister, I've been hearing her talk about, I feel so guilty. She must, every time I talk with her, she must use the word, I feel so guilty. And then another thing she says is, oh, I just worry all the time. I just worry all the time. I just worry all the time. I feel so guilty. So I started listening to what she's speaking. Today on the phone, I thought, you know what? We're going to take care of that. And I didn't even ask her permission to pray for her. I just went for it. And as I was praying for her, you know, I am sick of that spirit of guilt. We're going for it. And I just started praying for her, and I went back to her childhood because she was the oldest of the girls. This woman, she was cooking and cleaning and babysitting at 4 years old. I'm not kidding you. My mother was working somewhere and would bring her friend home for lunch so the 4-year-old daughter could cook biscuits for them and brag about it. My sister kept the house spotless. I told her in my book, you'll see, she was more like a mother to me. And I told her, I go, we were really blessed that you were the oldest one because you kept the house clean and you kept organized and you had it all together. I go, if I was the oldest one, we'd all be out having fun. Nothing would have been done. But you know, as I prayed for her today, the Holy Spirit yanked me back to what this poor girl has gone through. And when she was getting ready to marry this husband that she's married to now, they've been married a really long time, he took her to premarital counseling, and the counselor asked her to think back when she was five. And the counselor took her back to the age of five and said, "What do you see at the age of five?" And she started crying. And she says, "I see me on my front porch just exhausted from all the work at 5 years old." And so the Holy Spirit had me pray specifically for over-responsibility, for always being worried about not enough food, because she was smart enough and wise enough to see we didn't have any food, so she worried about not having the finances. Her temperament was one to pay attention. Mine was one to detach. And so she worried about that. She was always guilty for not taking care of things better because my father was abusive to the children. And so she would stand up and have a voice and tell him not to beat the kids or not to do this. So she had guilt for not being able to do better. And you know, it was so amazing because the Holy Spirit just right there. Right there. And when we got done, she says, "Oh, God did something today." So you listen to when people are talking to you. "I'm so afraid. I'm so nervous. I'm so anxious. I just want to die." What are they saying? And what demonic spirit is attached to that? Do you understand what I'm saying? Listen. I love what our student said about finding things, listening to what she's thinking, and how the Holy Spirit was naming things that she was, and then where it even entered at, and how this thing had taken hold of her, and to be able to name it. But sometimes where did it enter is so important, because when you get that area healed or that area ministered to, many times that thing starts losing power. Amen? So you want to get the background. You want to pray over the room. I usually have the person close their eyes, but I keep my eyes open most of the time. Sometimes I forget, and I close my eyes, but the Holy Spirit will say, "Open your eyes," because when you're praying someone through inner healing, you're seeing things. Sometimes you go to the womb, and all of a sudden, demons are surfacing, movements happening, jaws are moving, tension is happening, tears are coming, so you're watching the person you're praying for. And as you pray them through the womb and through the birth, and then pray them through their life, you're watching how they react. Usually after I get finished praying inner healing, I ask the Holy Spirit to show the person if they're holding someone in unforgiveness. Now, I don't ask the person if they're holding someone in unforgiveness, because a lot of times they go, "No." But if you ask the Holy Spirit to show them if they're holding someone in unforgiveness, and I ask the Holy Spirit to quickly bring it to their conscious level mind, and then I ask the person to speak the names if the Holy Spirit brings someone to their mind, and I write those names down, then I ask the person to pray after me. I get the person's will involved. And as I get the person's will involved, I have them pray a prayer after me. So the prayer I have them pray after me is I have them release the people that they've named from all their bitterness, resentment, anger, and unforgiveness. Now, this can be a really hard prayer for your client to pray if there's still a lot of hurt attached. because it's harder to forgive if they're still hurt. So as you watch your client, if they can't release these people, then you go back and pray for more healing behind the hurt and the wounding that these people have caused. More healing for the hurt that these people have caused. It's easier to get your client to forgive if the healing has been taken care of. If there's still deep wounds, then it's very difficult to forgive and to let go of bitterness, because unforgiveness brings torment and a root of bitterness. Then you have your client pray for these people to be saved, to be healed, to be delivered. Hurting people hurt people. Broken people hurt people. Your client's issue is not with these other people, but with the demonic. We don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, dominions, wickedness. So hurting people are going to hurt people. And we get very wounded by people that are hurt that have demons, because the demons want us hurt. So we want to pray for God to heal these people, to deliver these people, to bring salvation if they're not saved. Many times you're going to find people will hold themselves in unforgiveness. And you need to work on having your client forgive themselves, possibly. If a person's committed adultery and the marriage got broke up and they can't forgive themselves, or something happened and they can't forgive themselves, then we have to teach our clients what the blood of Jesus is all about. And what we're telling God is, the power at the cross is not big enough for my sin. And I remember backsliding so bad at one point, I told God to move out of my way. And God kept calling me back. It's like, no, God, not now. I'm sorry. This time I've blown it. I could accept your forgiveness when I was a baby Christian and you started showing me my sin, and I could forgive and let go. But now I deliberately backslid. On purpose, I told you to move. And I'd been walking in the power of the Holy Spirit. And God said, my blood was shed for you, for your past, for your present, and for your future. And you know, sometimes it's hard when we've done damage to our family. If we've done sin, if we've committed the sin, for us to forgive. So it's hard for us to forgive ourselves sometimes. And what we have to do is teach our client how important the blood is. So do you know how important the blood is for your sins? Do you know how important and how you've been forgiven of all your sins? And it's important for you to know that. Because the enemy will use things like unworthiness against us. You're not worthy. So when you're ministering to someone, getting them to forgive themselves could be an area. But you have to know what the blood is for yourself, for you to teach that. And then there's times where people hold God in unforgiveness. My precious aunt had an 8-month-old baby that died of spinal meningitis overnight. They went out to dinner, got a babysitter, baby had a cold. They came home from out to dinner, the baby got really sick, took the baby to the hospital and dead the next morning. And my aunt was so angry at God. How could God take my baby? This baby was the cutest, the happiest, the sweetest. And you can imagine an eight-month-old, how adorable they are. And the heartache of my aunt for years of being angry at God. On her deathbed, I got to lead her to the Lord. But it is important that you even know your client could be holding God in unforgiveness. And so to know how to lead them through that. And I think in The Bride of Christ, I talk about that. And they need to literally say after you, I release you, God. I realize it's not your fault. Satan lied to me. And I believe Satan, because Satan will do things, then lie to people that it's God's fault that it happened. So you have to then know yourself. You can't be holding God in unforgiveness. But release God and have your client release God. When you're listening to the whole area of a person, Lucia was reminding me today of a woman we ministered to at the other building. And the woman had been in like three or four deadly crashes. She should have been killed three or four times. I mean, it was horrible. She came in with horrible back pain. She was just a mess. She couldn't work. Her life was falling apart. Finances was falling apart. She should have been killed literally in these car accidents that she had had. They were so horrible, horrendous car accidents. And I asked her if she had ever had an abortion. And she said yes. And then as I called up the spirit of death, Hades, murder, and suicide, because I felt like there was a death curse on her, a murdering demon on her, that it turned out to be generational. And it went back to the grandmother of having abortions. So the grandmother, the mother, and she had had five abortions. Do you know God delivered her that day? God delivered her that day and healed her. And what is so amazing is she was able to go back to work. She worked in Hollywood. Do you know she has sent so many people through the ministry that she has met at work and sent them through, because the miracle of her life of repenting and renouncing and breaking that abortion demonic spirit that had gone down through the bloodline. So listening, near-death experiences, usually death is around somewhere. So what is going on? A person has fear. They have anxiety. They have panic attacks. There's fear there. And so you want to hear intimidation, where they don't have a voice. They're afraid of man, afraid of anger, afraid of rejection, afraid of abandonment. So you're listening to these things. You're listening for them. And again, I usually have my client close their eyes and I tell them that I'm going to not speak to them, but I'm going to speak through them. And when I speak through them, it's going to be like a word association game. When I say black, what do you think of? So the very first thing that comes to your mind, what do you think of if I say dog? So it's that quick. If you've got demonic, they're always talking to you. They're always putting their thoughts in your mind. And so I don't talk to the person, I talk through the person, and I talk to the spirit. And I let the person know, if they feel like cussing me out, cuss me out. I'm not going to be upset about it. I'm not going to take it personally. But if I get a little angry sounding, don't be offended. Because I'm going to be talking to the demon and not to you. And I won't be offended when that demon's talking to me. But I know what the demon is thinking. Amen? So I asked the demon. Now, I've already got kind of a history, this particular woman. It was abortion, so I'm assuming it's death, Hades, murder, and suicide. I call it the highest ranking spirit of death. And I ask it if it's an assignment, a curse, or generation. Now, Charles Craft, he goes through all kinds. To me, some of the things he does, it seems a little hard. It seems a little over than what needs to be done. I just want to cut the taproots and get rid of it. And I don't need to go back 3, 4, 5, 6 generations. I'm just going to take care of it. Amen? Now, sometimes the person has to repent. They repent of their sins and their forefathers' sins. And they renounce the demon that's followed the bloodline. The next class, we're going to go into this a lot more. But I want to give this to you because Charles Craft is talking about this in this next chapter that you're going to be reading for your homework. So I want you to understand how I do it, because I believe it's really important of how the Holy Spirit's taught me. Not that his way is wrong, but it just seems like the Holy Spirit's over 35, 40 years of inner healing and deliverance has given me some knowledge that I want to impart to you. So I ask if it's generation, if it's an assignment, or if it's a curse. Now, generational is a demon that's been passed down through the bloodline. And it might have any number of reasons why it got into the bloodline. But it's usually the sins of the forefathers. If it's a curse, sometimes word curses is placed on people. I had a curse. My nickname was Dum Dum. My curse was I felt so stupid I could never learn. Didn't go to school. Time I was 18, didn't finish school. I just knew I couldn't learn anything. I was just too stupid. I ditched school more than I went, because when you're trying to survive life, many times it's very difficult to pay attention at school. I was hungry when I went to school. In the book I told you, I even stole somebody's lunch and went to the bathroom and ate it because I was so hungry. All I could do is look at that clock thinking, when is it going to be lunchtime? There was many times I would finally show up at school. I was rejected at school. I'm sure we were filthy. I'm sure we were very dirty. And so there was a lot of rejection at school. I ditched a lot. When I would go to school, I would kind of pay attention. I would start wanting to answer the question. I know that answer. And the teacher wouldn't call on me. Well, my temperament is you've got to keep me engaged somehow. And I would start talking. They would kick me out of the class. I don't even know how they sent me to the next grades. I must have ditched over half of the school year. And the other half, I was sitting outside the classroom. So many times, you can't concentrate. So my nickname was Dum Dum. My parents would ask me a question. I remember one time, I was a little girl, and something about me getting pregnant. And I had a puzzled look on my face, and I go, men can't get pregnant? Can they? And they started laughing. Oh, you're so dumb. Ha, ha, ha. You're so stupid. So they would even give me trick questions at times and make fun of me and call me Dum Dum. So by the time I was 18, I really felt I was stupid. And so word curses are so real. Curses are so, so real. You know, people... I love studying the Jewish roots, because on Shabbat, the father blesses the children. The father blesses the wife. The wife blesses the husband. It's so beautiful, blessings on a Friday night. Well, that didn't happen in my house. People got drunk, beat up, and there was curses in my house. There was no such thing as blessings in my house. And kids are to be seen and not heard. And, you know, be quiet. You don't know anything. And if you saw something like dad kissing another woman in a bar, you didn't see that. So there's things of confusion when you're seeing something happen, but you're being told that's not what you saw. So you grow up thinking that your emotions or your feelings or what you think isn't as important or right like other people's. Anybody? You're not as important. You don't have the right to speak your feelings or your thoughts. That's huge. That could be a curse on you of thinking everyone else is smarter than you and you don't have any right to have a voice. There's many curses, financial curses, that I believe if people gamble and drink and spend their money in other ways than the way God intended for it to be spent, you don't tithe, I believe there's curses on you. There's financial curses. That it's a curse. I had poverty and lack mentality. Those were curses, those were demons that kept me in poverty. God's not broke. And when we do it His way, we're going to be blessed. Amen? That He can meet our needs. So you want to find out if it's generational, if it's a curse, if it's an assignment. Assignments are sent directly from Satan. You've done nothing wrong. Your ancestors have done nothing wrong. And Charles Kraft doesn't seem to address this particular legal right that demons have. But usually, if you have a call on your life and Satan knows it, now many people say Satan doesn't know the future, Satan doesn't know your call. I have to disagree with that because the assignments that I talk to, they don't want to let the person go. They are there to destroy this person because they want to stop the call that's on their life. And to me, I think of it like a football game. You've got the ball. You're ready to make a touchdown. You've got a whole defense team that's come after you. And it can be names like destruction. That it is there, its assignment is to destroy you. It could be hopelessness and discouragement and despair just to make you give up, just to make your life so heavy that you can't go forward in your Christian walk. Because if you have all that heaviness on you, you can't even get into the Word. You can't go forward. Is that true with anybody out there? So these things are assignments that is there sent directly from Satan. And I can see at times there's clusters. We talked a week or two ago about clusters. Depression, hopelessness, discouragement, despair. And I see them playing you like a ping pong ball. To depression. To hopelessness. Back over to despair. Back over to depression. Back over to discouragement. And all day long, you're just going through these emotions, and you feel so weighed down. Anybody ever feel anything like that? And these can be assignments. If you start stepping out to bring someone to the Lord, to pray, to minister, it's like wham. I think one of our students said that they had just brought somebody to the Lord, and things were going great, and all of a sudden, they just got slammed. And their life has never been the same. Hitchhiking spirits, retaliating spirits, these things are so real that we battle. We don't even know we're battling because we think it's our own thoughts. The battle is in the mind. How about then turning to gluttony or alcohol or drugs to ease the emotional pain? I remember years ago, I would pray all day for my family. I would battle, but I didn't know that I was really in battle. I just kind of thought I might be in battle. And I would pray for my kids that were ditching school and smoking pot, and I would pray and pray and pray for their salvation. And by the end of the night, it would be like, I need a drink. And I remember I would sit down and go, I gotta have a glass of wine. And a couple of glasses of wine just to, I was so stressed because I was fighting this all day long. And Then all of a sudden, before long, the Lord said to me, you're fighting all day long. You're doing great. You've got this, there's a real battle going on. And there's this line between you and the enemy. And he says, all day you're shooting and shooting and shooting and shooting. And at the end of the day, you take your armor off, you lay it aside, you cross over to the enemy's camp. And then you party with the enemy. And it's like, oh, I never thought about that. So the enemy will use anything, and we don't even know at times we're being used. I think the other thing that I've come across when I'm struggling with the demon that doesn't want to leave, I find out what its legal right is to be there. You might have cut taproots and unholy soul ties. You might have taken the legal right of an assignment away. You might have found that there's a curse there, and you've destroyed that curse with the blood of Jesus or the blood of Yeshua. So you've taken all legal rights away, but it's still there. And I've asked it at times, what gives you a legal right to still be here? Why are you still here? Why did you not leave when I told you to leave? A couple of responses. One is, I don't want to leave. One, they're going to be tortured when they get back to Satan. You guys don't understand the spiritual realm. Satan tortures them when they let go of you. Satan's not happy that a saint got delivered. And these poor demons, when they show back up in front of Satan, they've cried. They've told me. One time I was shocked because I go, well, Satan's going to throw you a party when you get back there. And they started crying and said, no, it's not like that at all. You don't understand. We can't let go of this one. This one has such a call on their life. They're going to do serious damage to my kingdom. You don't understand the trouble I'm going to be in. And they start crying. That they are really going to be in trouble when they get back to Satan. So they are holding on with everything they have to not let go. But there's been other times that I found that the person has made an agreement with them. The person has made an agreement. When you're depressed, you're hopeless, you're discouraged, you're in despair, and you start listening to that thing. Dr. Margaret, you're a perfect example of making an agreement with the enemy. She was on her deathbed. I think you guys probably heard the story 100 times. 2.5 weeks of her deathbed, literally inches away from death. And God told me in the morning time to go in and tell her to quit making an alliance with the spirit of death. She was inches away from dying. Inches away. She was in and out of conscience. I went in. I spoke what the Lord told me to spoke. She came back. She realized she was agreeing with death because it would have been easier just to die because she was so sick. That was about 1 in the afternoon. By 5 in the afternoon, she was out of her deathbed. She was up talking, eating. I think they put her in regular room the next day. They wanted to keep her overnight to make sure because they were shocked that she had rallied back so incredibly. People can make alliances. They hear these thoughts and they think it's their own thoughts, so they agree with it. They agree with depression. They agree with hopelessness. They agree with despair. They agree with poverty. I'll never get out of debt. My life is too hard. And so you make an agreement with these things. So I have to make the agreement null and void. I take that legal right away. And if you've made an agreement with any of these things, you repent of it. You make it null and void. Sometimes the person has to forgive. One man he was in such physical pain, and the war was going on for 3 or 4 hours, and I couldn't make the demon leave. And finally, the Holy Spirit said, ask the demon what gives it a legal right. And the demon said, I have his heart cut in 4 ways. Now, this man had every right to be holding 4 people in unforgiveness. His father did something horrible, his mother did something horrible, his sister did something horrible, and his ex-wife was driving him crazy. And that demon was using those 4 incidences to keep him in unforgiveness. And there was a demonic spirit of torment. Unforgiveness brings torment, and it's real. So I brought the man back, quit talking to the demon, and that was kind of a challenge. And I helped this young man realize how important forgiveness is. That his battle was not with these 4 people, but with the demonic. So you always have to remember, keep finding out what the legal right is. I know one of our students said that she didn't want to talk to the demons. But you know, when the demons know that you know your authority, your rank outranks their rank. Your commander-in-chief defeated their commander-in-chief. And when you know your authority, they know your authority. And they've been found out. But they also know when you don't know your authority. And they know that they can do all kinds of crazy things with you because you don't know who you are. But once you really, really understand your position, and your commander-in-chief defeated their commander-in-chief, and you have full legal right and authority, then they will submit to that authority. Again, I want to bring up in this next chapter you're going to read that Charles Kraft talks about putting the demons in boxes. My personal opinion of years of experience, I don't do that. I take the highest ranking demon in that cadre. I find out its legal rights. I take care of its legal rights, and I tell him to take all his demons in his cadre. What is a cadre? A cadre is a group of demons. Like in the army, you have, a lieutenant with privates underneath. So you have these little minions that go along with the highest ranking demon, and I command him to take all of them. There's been times in finding out the legal rights for a demon to still be here, if it's generational, I have found that, let's say it's a mother that has a couple of children, and I need to break the generational curse over the children before the demon will leave. And so I will pray against the generational curse over the children, and then the demon leaves. Sometimes I'll ask the demon, what else do you have to tell me before you leave? Because they're not leaving. And I remember the demons telling me that it's because there's still generational demons on their children. So I've been able to do that. I like to replace the demons with the Word of God. If it's a spirit of fear, God's not giving you a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and a sound mind. So you're replacing the lie of the demon with the truth. The person is not rejected and abandoned, they're accepted in the beloved. There's not hopelessness, but there's hope. There's not discouragement, there's encouragement. There's life more abundantly. God has come to give life, not death. He defeated death at Calvary. So the more of the word you have in you, I love to replace the demonic spirit with the Word of God. Amen? Sometimes I have a person repeat it. If I'm dealing with a spirit of rejection and abandonment, I will have the person speak the truth out loud. I am not rejected, I'm accepted. And you'll see the battle going on to get the demon, but the person is weakening the demon by speaking the truth out loud. You should always be prayed up. You can do nothing apart from your Father. If there's areas of your life of sin, you need to deal with that. Because sin is nothing more than a demon that's tempted you and you've given it an open door. So you want to deal with the sin because Satan will expose your sin. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? I know of one case where the man that was helping do a deliverance had been into a homosexual lifestyle and nobody knew it. That demon pointed it right out. The man was devastated that his stuff was put out there. So it is important that you get yourself spiritually right. Because when you're spiritually right, you have a lot more power. When you're weakened by sin, you've got the demonic weakening you. So you start asking God, especially this Passover season that we're in, start asking God, search me, O God. When you start justifying your actions, when you start justifying what you're doing, I can steal this because of, I can cheat over here on my taxes because of, I can manipulate over here because of, when you start going through your mind and you start justifying and you find yourself justifying something, it's usually a demon tempting you. So what is it that you're trying to justify? Ask God to expose it. Amen? Because you want to be completely clean. Then you want to seal the work up. I don't like to pray for somebody longer than 2 hours. The man that was teaching me how to do deliverance, that I threw 90% of the stuff, if not more, out, we would start at like 9 in the morning and go to 5 or 6 in the afternoon. It wears you out, it wears the person out. He did all kinds of crazy things like angels dipping the demons in jacuzzi baths and slicing them and dicing them and pureating them. And, you know, there's a lot of stuff out there that's not biblical. And it's important that we do it God's way and not come up with ways. Somebody was saying earlier that what they were being taught was not necessarily the truth. And God brought them here to teach them a better way of doing it. There's people out there that like to get demonic spirits all riled up because they feel that it's a big show. We're not here to get the demons. We want people free. We want to heal them and deliver their soul that they could be everything that God wants them to be. We don't need a big show. Amen? So there's things that you might have learned elsewhere. Ask the Holy Spirit to give you truth, because I had to throw out so much stuff but I think I had to learn the wrong before I could learn the right, because now I see how powerful the right. Because people weren't being completely set free. They were coming back with the same problems after hours. And so 2 hours is enough. Many times on Lucia, when she first started working with me, she couldn't believe it. I had to go pick up my daughter from school. I go, I'm going to put a comma right here. I'll be back. And I left Lucia in the room with the person going through the deliverance, and I would come back and we'd pick up. Or I had to go to the bathroom. The person was going through inner healing. The Holy Spirit was doing it. I would sneak out and come back. And the Holy Spirit was still doing the Holy Spirit work. And so, you know, it's the Holy Spirit doing the work, and he doesn't do everything all in one day. People didn't get here all in one day. And sometimes he goes layers and layers. And you know what? You might only be a part of that. It might be the beginning. And you might not ever see that person again. But you shouldn't wear them out or wear yourself out. The other thing, make appointments. If you have a family, don't leave your family just standing for 2 or 3 hours while you're ministering. I made the biggest mistake when a demon would surface and be, oh, a demon, we got to take care of it right now. That person's had that demon most of their life. A whole week isn't going to make a big difference. Amen? So we need to remember that you can make appointments. You can stop things and come back to things. 2 hours. Sometimes you might go 3, but just remember this person's going through major, major surgery. This is heart surgery. And when they've gone through deliverance, they're going to be exhausted. And they're going to be emotional. You're bringing up stuff that they've never brought up before. So be careful of how long you take somebody through this. Give them a break. 2 hours. Then you want to close down. You want to ask God to bring it to full completion. He started it. He can bring it to full completion. You want to come against hitchhiking spirits, retaliating spirits, assignments against you, against your family, against your pets, against your finances. These demons are like the mafia. They go after your family if they can't get you anymore. But you know what's exciting? Is that God's big enough to take care of them too. And you know what? They might have to walk through their own stuff. But I've learned one thing, to praise God no matter what. To praise Him in the dark and praise Him in the light. When I see my kids backsliding, when I see them going through stuff, I can trust that God is going to take care of them. If He can take care of us and get us through our stuff, He's big enough to take care of everybody else, and we don't have to rescue them. Amen? So pray for them, cover them, but realize that God is still in control, and He's going to work all things together for good for those who love the Lord and are called for His purpose. Amen? So I'm going to close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank You right now. Father, we thank You for teaching us all that You're teaching us. I thank You for the hours of instruction that You took me through, Father, to raise up this army today, Father. Father, it's not for our glory. It's not to say we found a demon, but it's all for Your kingdom, all for Your glory, all to set the saints free. To go into that prison house and set the captives free and bind up their broken hearts. Father, we thank You for this privilege of to partner with You in Your kingdom. In Yeshua's name, amen.